In addition to the well-accepted theories of failure for ductile and brittle materials, we will also study two more theories which are called theories of historical significance. So when we say historical significance, these were the theories they were proposed earlier, but now we don't use any more. Some other theories, the theories that you have studied earlier are far better than these theories. Here we study only for the sake of completeness. The first one is maximum principal strain theory. So it should not be confused with the maximum principal stress theory. It's a maximum principal strain theory, also known as St. Venant's theory. And the second one is total strain energy theory, also known as Beltrami-Haig theory. So earlier we have studied a similar theory, you know, called the distortional strain energy theory, but it is only total strain energy theory here. The first one let's study, that is maximum principal strain theory. This theory predicts that failure occurs when maximum normal strain at a point equals or exceeds the maximum normal strain at the time of failure in a simple uniaxial test of the material. So what is the meaning of that? Let's say we have at some point in the material, I want to know whether the component has failed or not. What you have to do is, I have to measure the strain at this point. So according to this theory, if you want to measure the failure at a point, say let's a point in a body of our interest, so here you can measure epsilon 1, epsilon 2 and epsilon 3. So you have to arrange them in a decreasing order. So epsilon 1 is greater than epsilon 2 is greater than epsilon 3. Okay. So you take the maximum value and minimum value. If your maximum value is, if E1, epsilon 1 is the maximum value, if it crosses the failure strain of the material, or if minimum value is less than the failure strain, minus of failure strain, we can say component has failed. This failure strain is obtained from the test, UTM test, okay, that is a simple tensile test. You apply the load and wait until the component fails. At the time of failure, whatever strain you have, that strain is known as failure strain. So basically you have to compare at any the strains at any point with the strains observed in a UTM machine, then you will get the condition for maximum normal strain theory. Here in this equations we have written, you can compare E1, E2, E3, individually you can compare whether it falls. For example, if you, if I show you in the number line, okay. So if I plot the strain values in this, let me say this is strain, this is minus EF, failure strains. And your E1, E2, E3, that is epsilon 1, epsilon 2, epsilon 3 are within this range, the component is safe. If they are crossing this point, the component has failed. So therefore, if you take the maximum value, if E1 crosses this value, then it has failed. And if the minimum value crosses this, that is E3 is smaller than this, then it has crossed this boundaries, then also it has failed. So component is safe only when all the three strains are within this limit, that is minus epsilon F2 plus epsilon F. And as you can see from the equations, this theory assumes the failure strain is same in both tension and compression. Therefore, we use the same epsilon F with a negative sign here in this case. Okay. Sometimes it is possible to express this theory in terms of stress also. For that, we will use generalized Hooke's law. Hooke's law basically relates the strain versus strain with the stresses. So the epsilon 1, epsilon 2 and epsilon 3 can be written in terms of the principal stresses, and when you substitute back in the equation, and similarly the failure strain can be written in terms of failure stress. Okay, so this is RHS of the equation, and this one this is your LHS of the equation. Okay, so when you put it back in the original equation, you can get the equation of this nature. Okay. So this is nothing but epsilon 1 and this is epsilon F. So this was the condition. We have written this in terms of stresses. So therefore the final equation for maximum normal strain can be written something like this. So this will be the equation. So though we don't use it quite often, but we are studying it for the sake of continuity. The simpler way of doing this would be, for example, if I want to make this as a design equation, I just have to replace the failure strain, okay, this failure strain sigma yp with the sigma yp by n, where n is a factor of safety, just like other cases. And the simpler way of looking at is, if you know the principal stresses sigma 1, sigma 2 and sigma 3, and if you can arrange them in this order so that sigma 1 is greater than sigma 2 is greater than sigma 3, so you can rewrite this equation for maximum normal strain theory as this equation. Okay, so that is a simpler way of doing this, and the same equation gets reduced to 2D. If it is 2D, we know the third out of plane stress sigma c is equal to 0, we have only two stresses, and therefore the equation can be reduced to this format. That is all about maximum principal strain theory. Or you can remember this equation, sigma 1 minus nu, sigma 2 plus sigma 3 should be greater than or equal to sigma yp, or it should be less than minus sigma yp. So if that is satisfied, then the condition, that will be the condition for failure in case of maximum normal strain theory. Then we'll move on to total energy density theory. This is the second theory of historical significance. So this theory is also known as the Beltrami-Haig theory. So we'll, according to this theory, it predicts failure, okay, this failure occurs when total strain energy density at a point equals or exceeds the maximum strain energy density at the time of failure in a simple uniaxial test of the material. So this is similar to earlier distortion energy theory, except that in distortion energy theory we used only the distortion part, if you remember. So the total strain energy can be split into two parts. One is hydrostatic, another one is distortional. So we, in the distortion energy theory, we discarded the hydrostatic part because that was not contributing to the failure. We only concentrated the distortion components. So but here in this case we consider both the energies together and we get what is known as total strain energy density. So that's because it is considering both the components, it's not a more accurate theory, but however we'll study as a part of our continuity. So this theory says, so failure occurs when strain energy density, that is total strain energy density, is more than or equal to the total strain energy density at the time of failure, okay, that is nothing but the time of failure in a simple tensile test. Okay, so we already derived an expression for total strain energy density in earlier discussions. So this is an expression, okay, this expression for total strain energy density written in terms of three principal stresses, sigma 1, sigma 2 and sigma 3, and we have nu as Poisson's ratio and E is Young's modulus. This is a general expression. Now this we have to compare with the strain energy density at the time of failure. So at the time of failure we know the conditions. What is the condition? At the time of failure in a UTM machine we have sigma 1 is equal to sigma failure. So sigma failure means it could be sigma yield point or it could be sigma ultimate stress, okay, and other components of principal stresses are 0, sigma 2 is equal to 0, sigma 3 is equal to 0. So when you substitute here, you will get an expression for UT at failure in this fashion, okay. So therefore, the final expression for strain energy density can be written like this, okay. So the LHS represents the strain energy, total strain energy density at any point in a body, whereas the sigma f square represents the total strain energy density of the material at failure, okay. So this is a fun expression, and if you want to introduce the factor of safety, you just have to divide failure stress by n, because we have got sigma f square, here you will get sigma f by n whole square. So again, in case of 3D stress, 2D state of stress, one of the component is, that is out of plane principal stress, is 0. So this equation gets reduced to this format. So sigma c is 0, so you will have only sigma a square plus sigma b square minus 2 nu, sigma a, sigma b is, should be greater than or equal to sigma f by n whole square. So this is about total strain energy density.